Dianne Donovan,
and I'm the midday host here at KMFA Midday Oasis and host of Classical Austin. We want to welcome you to the Draylen Mason Music Studio for our midday concert series, and you are in for a treat. You will get a sneak peek and listen to Zach Theater's presentation of George Gershwin Alone as realized by the amazing Hershey Felder. And he has put on many, many shows over the years. This is the 25th year of this show. So you'll get to meet him, ask George, as well as himself. And now, here is Hershey Felder.
I somehow still manage. It's nice to meet you all. It's wonderful to be here in Austin.
Well, and it's lovely to have you. It's
Thank
lovely
you. To have you here in Austin. I understand that this was a few years in the making in terms of getting you here. Is that correct?
Actually, we were contracted to come here before COVID. And I was supposed to be here in 2019, and then 2020. We all know what happened. And it took 3 years to finally get to barbecue capital of the universe. I've actually told the dresser at the theater that she needs to be ready to let out the pants as the show goes on. Because if you're here, you know, I will tell you this. I live in Florence and Venice, not the ones here in America, those. And you know, I mean, we're total foodies there. And I said, oh no, I'm going to the United States. What am I going to do without my daily pasta? And I got off the plane in Austin. And I said, ooh, it's not bad. It's a lot of really nice food things here. So I'm thrilled to be here.
We are delighted to have you here. Well, you are a playwright, a pianist, actor, singer, and composer. And those particular talents have set you up beautifully to create these amazing shows. I think they're unique. We know about Gershwin, obviously, but you've also brought about shows on Chopin, Beethoven, and Debussy and such. Mm-hmm. I've seen other people do tribute shows, but you do it all. Please tell us the fascinating story of how you created this brand, if you will.
The whole thing emanated from a desperate need to pay rent. It's absolutely the case. You know, I was a young pianist and a young actor. Both of those things were separate. I was acting, and we share a love city. We were both born in Montreal,
yes.
Canada.
We
talk about food, so we already had the bagel discussion. Let me tell you, no matter what you think you know in Austin about bagels, you don't know about bagels until you have been to Montreal, right? So I grew up there. I went to McGill as a very young kid, at 13 years old, in piano, also doing theater there. You may or may not remember this organization, but the Sadie Brofman Center and the Yiddish Theater. So my very first experience on stage was at the Yiddish Theater of Montreal. I was just a kid, and I figured that everybody who is over 30 years old speaks like this with an accent, you know, because everybody's speaking like this. So I thought that's what's going to happen. But I did get into television, a little film, and these two things were separate, the piano and studying music and being an actor. And I always said I wanted to combine them. And everybody said, that's not possible. They're two different mechanisms. Nobody's going to come. Who's going to care? Nobody's going to be interested in what you do. I said, well, let me try. And so the first thing I tried was in Montreal at the Sadie Brofman Center, playing the role of Chopin and in character. And I thought that would be interesting. And a few people did come. I mean, I was 18, so. But there was attendance. And I thought, well, maybe this is interesting. Then I go to New York, and I study with Jerry Lowenthal, who was at Juilliard at the time. And I become a proper pianist, so I'd like to think. And also doing acting. And I also fell into directing and acting in Hal Prince's studio. And you know Hal Prince for all the great things that he had done. And they were still separate at this point. And then something really kind of miraculous happened. I said I was born in Montreal. I've told you I was in the Yiddish theater, so that is a first language. First language is French, actually. French, English, Yiddish, and Hebrew were my first languages. But my grandparents were immigrants. They were immigrants post-war. They survived. My mother's parents survived on false papers in Hungary, and my father's parents survived in Poland. Pretty much everybody perished in the camps. It was only these two small groups who came out, my mother and my father's groups. Anyway, Yiddish was a very important thing for us at home. And I've never been shy of my heritage. Of all the things I've done, all the characters totally unrelated to any kind of Jewish sense, I've never been shy and I've never pretended not to be who I am. I thought that was very important. And one of the things I did do was speak Yiddish in a lot of plays. I came to the attention of Steven Spielberg because I spoke Yiddish when he had done Schindler's List. And suddenly I found myself out in Hollywood as a very young person when this happened. And I was tapped as a 23-year-old or whatever it was to interview Holocaust survivors, not as part of his program after Schindler's List, not just in the United States, but actually at the 50th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz. And I was one of four interviewers. I had gone, and I was interviewing in Yiddish. One of the people that I interviewed was a fellow by the name of Helmut Spreitzer, who was Dr. Mengele, you know, the evil doctor, his runner boy. He was a Jewish boy, but he said he used to whistle. And one of the things he used to whistle was the Rhapsody in Blue because his parents had a record of it. And he said something fascinating. You know that first theme. He said, "Can't you hear the trains whistling?" And I said, "What are you talking about, the trains whistling?" And he said, "Do you hear the trains and do you hear the people screaming?" And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he said that he heard in the Rhapsody in Blue that George Gershwin was a prophet. He understood what was going to happen in the Jewish people, having composed this piece in 1924. By this point, I thought this guy was completely insane. But he kept on repeating this story, and he told me this story over and over again. And I just so happened to have a book on Gershwin there with me in Krakow, where we were in Poland. And I looked it up, and sure enough, George Gershwin says exactly this. "I could hear the sounds of America. I could hear the future of our country. I could hear the sounds of the street. In fact, I heard the train, and I heard its whistle." And then he said, "I heard the rattly bang of the train tracks." "I heard a musical kaleidoscope of America." And I thought, this guy was hearing this in this music that he was whistling for American people who saved, you know, who liberated. And he heard these, that, and he said George Gershwin heard it, but he said he whistled it while he was there to keep him somewhat sane, because it was the only American record his parents had in their home in Berlin when he was a little boy. Fine. I come back to an America, I say, this is a fascinating story to tell. I tell the story on a stage in Los Angeles. I'm in my early 25 years old. And of course, it repeated in the news and it gets reviewed. And the next thing I get is a cease and desist letter from the Gershwin family. "We don't want you to associate the Holocaust with George Gershwin, blah, 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 blah. It's not to be done." I said, "But there's a legitimate story here." They said, "Never mind." And that was the end of that. And then I put in a call to Michael Feinstein, and I said, "Do you know any of the Gershwins?" He said, "Yes, I know this one, I know that one. Who would you like to meet?" I said, "Let me meet one of them, at least try and convince them." I had lunch with Adam Gershwin, who is the great-nephew of George Gershwin, and I said, "You know, I'd like to tell this story." He says, "Well, we'll never let you do something like this." I said, out of my mouth, "Well, how about if I play the role of George Gershwin himself and tell his story?" "We'll consider that. We've never let that happen before." And so that happened, and I realized I might have a way to pay rent. And that's how it's quite literally all started. So you never know what direction you're... I told you I was full of stories. It's, yeah, we have no shortage of stories. You never know what direction your life is going to go in. May I do something musical on that?
Yes, please.
Okay,
please.
So you've heard a little bit about this Rhapsody. I'll tell you another funny story. We know the theme. Don't you see the airplane taking off? United Airlines, right? Do you know that George Gershwin sold this theme, the state, for $3 million? Imagine that. If George Gershwin would have known this theme was sold to United Airlines, just these 8-10 bars, for $3 million. So, a number of years later, after I'd become known for doing this, I was giving a concert in Paris, and I was in Paris, and I was invited to a dinner. And you'll have to, I remember a guy's name. And it was a dinner of about 10 people. And Richard Branson was there. Do you know who that is? Yeah. Richard was the guy, Virgin Airlines guy, and at the time he had Virgin Airlines. And I was asked to give a little talk like we're doing and answer a few questions and play a little Gershwin. And I told the story of George Gershwin and United Airlines and this being sold for, you know, $3 million for, you know, 20 bars. And I looked at Branson, who was sitting at the dinner table. I said, tell you what, for $1.5 million, I'll give you 40 bars. Completely original. So, you know, I'm kind of full of crazy stories that have happened. But one of the things that happened that was the most fun, that is really a lot about what we're doing here together, was I was on Broadway and I was playing this role, and all of a sudden people started to sing during the show. Can you imagine? I'm playing this, creating that very delicate rocking back and forth that I'll tell you about in a moment as well, which is another funny story. And all of a sudden, I'm about to talk about the reviews that George Gershwin got for this, which were not very good. And a woman in the balcony, "Summertime, how the living is." I thought I better take this in hand as fast as possible. And I decided to create an encore, a series of encores. I thought, you know, we'll do the show, and let's hope and pray that this doesn't happen again. And it did. It always happened. And then I said, I tell you what, as an encore, I finished the last notes of the Rhapsody. What is it? Yeah. Finished the Rhapsody, da-da-da, fine. And then I looked at the audience, I said, but clearly you haven't had enough. And I just started doing this. And I said, I tell you what, we're gonna go back to the 1930s. You can imagine a penthouse somewhere in New York City. You come in after the concert. George Gershwin is already there plugging his tunes because he want to be heard. It's like Oscar Levant said, you go to a George Gershwin opening, you think it's a revival because he's been playing his tunes again and again at the parties, right? So I said, you know, what did they used to do? You can imagine Kitty Carlisle standing around the piano and Oscar Levant and even Irving Berlin, Jerome Kern. Just imagine the people that were there at those parties. And I said, okay, everybody, we're at one of those parties, so why don't we create it? The words are, embrace me, my sweet embraceable you. Let's go. Everybody, and embrace me, my sweet embraceable you. Embrace me, you irreplaceable you. Embrace me, you irreplaceable you. Just one look at you. Just one look at you. My heart grew tipsy in me. You and you alone. You and you alone. Bring out the gypsy in me. We have some good solos here. I love all the many charms. I love everyone. Above all, I want my arms about you. Above all, I want my arms about you. Don't be a naughty baby, and don't be a naughty baby. Come to Papa, come to Papa. Ooh, very attentive in Austin. My sweet embraceable. Thank you. So one of the things that we saw was, oh my God, people love to sing. They love to remember those times where you stand around a piano and sing. And of course, for 3 years, we were forbidden to do any such thing. So what a thing to be able to come for my first time in Austin and do this with the audience and play the character. It's a proper play, but we get to have fun like that too. It brings people together in the most wonderful of ways. It's I'm full incredible. Of stories. You can
you
keep
are
on
full
going.
Of stories. Full and, of stories. You know, I had some questions written down, but Hershey said, if I may call you Hershey.
You must.
Or George.
No, Hershey, Hershey.
Okay, Hershey. Just said, no, just, you know, questions off the cuff and we'll go with it.
Sure.
And that reminded me of a quote of Gershwin's, which is, life is like jazz. It's best when you improvise. You probably know that quote. Mm. But I did want to ask you, Gershwin's life was so short, but his catalog so vast. How did you go about selecting the music and the stories you would tell in a show to encapsulate this great man?
Well, the important thing is that, especially when it comes to Gershwin, and really, I mean, any performance in the end, you have to give the public at least something that they want. This idea of going to the theater and saying, I'm going to torture you and giving you nothing that you want, and you will learn and you will be more intelligent for all my genius. I don't believe in that as much as I believe in sharing the experience. And so I knew the Rhapsody in Blue had to be in there. How could it not be, right? That was a given it was going to be. I knew that we had to do things like this together. But I also knew that I could weave in there elements of George Gershwin that people don't know. Little things like how his work was responded to by Henry Ford, a notorious anti-Semite. And things that I was able to weave in historically that were so interesting, contextual, and things that have, interesting, I started this show, the first performance was 98. That's a long time. And I've played over 6,000 live performances, not of this, of the whole catalog, Chopin, Beethoven, all the Bernstein, all the characters, but at least 3,000 Gershwins, because that was what was known, I became known for quickly. And it's amazing how the world has changed, because in the old days, you know, I've been away from you a long time. I never thought I'd miss you so. Somehow I feel your love was real. Knew you, I longed to be. You know, this is Al Jolson. Swanee, how I love you, how I love you, my dear old Swanee. Now, when we did that originally, it was just fun imitating the voice and so on. Now it comes under a whole other context because he did it in blackface. Then doing it in blackface 30 years ago was a historical fact. Now it always was a sensitive issue, but now we are sensitized to how sensitive that issue is. So there is a whole other context that comes in to this kind of storytelling that is very important to deal with. So the story itself, even though I haven't changed one word, the story itself has changed. The fact that this white Jewish boy somehow was able to put this black origin music onto a stage is a remarkable thing, because if not for him, a lot of those colors wouldn't have, musical colors wouldn't have been heard on a stage. It was Rudy Valli who said on his radio show, he said, we welcome George Gershwin. It's kind of tall and funny, you know, voice like this. Welcome George Gershwin, the man who has made a lady out of jazz. Now, that sounds like a very wonderfully florid descriptive thing until you think of the ramifications of what he's really saying. So jazz was garbage and low and whatever, and George Gershwin has elevated it. So there are historical things that are now so important and so wonderfully sensitive and give the whole thing a whole other color. And I'm an actor, pianist, who is lucky enough to have seen the country and our sensibilities change using the same words. And people would say to me, you know, I saw this 10 years ago, I came back to see it, you've changed so much. I said, I haven't changed so much, the world has changed. In fact, not one word has changed since you saw it the first time you saw it, you know, 10 years before. So those things are very interesting in terms of understanding this character and the reason for doing it. But the reason ultimately for doing this was to be able to create a story And that story, getting to your question, I'm so long-winded, I'm so sorry, but getting to your question, that is what guides what ends up being told in the story. You know you have to do Rhapsody in Blue, but how does Porgy and Bess fit into it? And must Porgy and Bess fit into it? And yes, it must, because if you don't consider the historical context of all these things, then you're not doing service to the memory and also the context. And also, the interesting thing to know is that George Gershwin always acknowledged, it was a very big mistake that he walked out there as the white Jewish boy able to do this. He very much so acknowledged that W.C. Handy, the father of the blues, was where he took so much of his work from, and he acknowledged it publicly. But there is a wonderful story. You can edit this out when it goes on the air, but there's a wonderful story where George Gershwin ended up in 1925 on the cover of Time magazine, which is one, he's one of the first people, you know, Time magazine wasn't that much older, he's one of the first artists to be on Time magazine, so his face was familiar. Because if you saw a photo of somebody in those days, it's not like today we're so inundated, you saw the cover of Time magazine, you remembered what that person looked like. So he had his photo on there, and he went to the mountains, to the Adirondacks, I think, with his friend, was it Irving Caesar? Somebody, one of his writer friends who wasn't Jewish. And as they're walking into the hotel, where Grossinger's was, well, you know, in the Adirondacks, I guess this is. The Catskills, thank you. He walked in with the Catskills. Somebody at the front door said, I'm sorry, but you know, Mr. Gershwin, we appreciate your work very well. But this is a non-Jew, if you're Jewish, you can't be here. He says, and the friend says, yeah, but he was on the cover of Time magazine. What do you mean he can't be here? No, it's no Jews allowed. We're very sorry, Mr. Gershwin, but you can't be here. So his friend told him, hang on here at the front door, just wait for me. The friend said, I'd like our room, please. Went upstairs, urinated around the perimeter, and left. So, you know, this is not new. It's all very, and understanding the context of this and contextualizing the history of where this music came from is important. And I think it's important for the world that we live in today to understand how much has changed in the country, how much hasn't, and what still needs to change, and understand and be sensitive to everything that is around us, because it's not always that easy. Things that we think are obvious aren't. So a lot of what guided the storytelling here or the musical choices were these kind of context issues.
Well, people talk about how young Mozart was when he passed, and mm-hmm. for me, I always wonder what would have happened had George Gershwin not died at the age of 30, at very young age.
38,
yeah. Yeah. And he was already bridging jazz and classical. Where do you think this would have gone?
Well, the interesting thing is that I've seen a couple of letters from people who knew him at the time. And you know, people are jealous and they're strange. Some musicians who knew him at the time said that he already explored all that was in his capacity to explore and that he died at the right time.
Wow.
Which is obnoxious, but you know, who wants to be, think of that, you know, oh, you look lovely, you've done a radio show, wonderful, it's time to die, you know?
And we don't remember their names.
No, we don't, but one of them we do, but I won't say what it is. You know, there were a lot of people who were quite mean to him. I mean, it's his sister's husband's father. So the Godowski, the pianist. So Godowski, the pianist, had a son who was also Godowski, Leopold Godowski, who was the inventor of Kodachrome. You don't want to be those two people's children, let me tell you. So the great pianist Godowski, and he said, when George Gershwin died, he cabled one of his other musicians, so you'll be going to the celebration today, I suppose. You know, there was a meanness, a viciousness, a jealousy and anger because George was so popular and classical. The stories never change. You know, you take one, it's the same thing. So in terms of you know him having died. So there were people who said he's explored all of it. Then there are others who said, well, if you can imagine, this is my theory, so I'm saying this. If you look at the Rhapsody, which is 1924, you look at the things that come next, and you look at 9 years later, which is, I guess, when he composed Porgy and Bess, the vast difference between that juvenile composition, as much as one enjoys the Rhapsody, it's still a juvenile composition. He was 26 years old. If you look at that and the growth between that and Porgy and Bess, or An American in Paris, which was the growth between Rhapsody and American in Paris is 2 or 3 years, which is astonishing, you can only imagine the capacity there would be for growth beyond Porgy and Bess and more. And at the end, the trouble was that he was working for Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, and Goldwyn said to him, why can't you write tunes that people can whistle? It's too complicated stuff that you write. It's so interesting to look at a real life and not just assume that the music is successful and so everybody had a good time. A real life is we all suffer in the same way at the hands of other people who are not always so kind, and he did, especially at the end. But I subscribe to the belief that the growth was that enormous in those 9 years, one can only imagine. Ira received a letter, his brother, some years later, in 1952, I think, asking what George was, and this letter is in the collection, I've seen it, what was George working on when he died? And Ira said, he was thinking about a ballet, he was thinking about another opera, he was thinking about this, that, and the other thing. But I can tell you this much, that whatever the result would have been of his efforts, it would have been entirely Gershwin, which I just loved. And so I feel that way about him, that way.
So do I. Well, speaking of his brother, Ira Gershwin wrote so many of the lyrics to these popular songs. Now, of course, George wrote purely instrumental music as well. But do you know anything about their working relationship? Did the words come first? Did they really work together? Or here you go, these are the words, take it.
I do. So let's give you a little bit of taste from this. Whereas I used to work with my melody book, my older brother, the thinker, Ira, he used to work with stacks and stacks and stacks of paper. I would jot down ideas once, Ira would write and cross out over and over again for days on end. We were working on I Got Rhythm. For Ethel Merman, for so-called Girl Crazy, we're having terrible trouble with the lyrics for the chorus. Well, the notes of this chorus are... We tried a number of rhyming schemes. Dummy lyrics, we called them. One such dummy went like this. Roly-poly, eating solely. Ravioli, better watch your diet or bust. Lunch or dinner, you're a sinner. Please get thinner, losing all that fat is a must. And the truth of the matter is, after many such dummies which went absolutely nowhere, my brother Ira finally turned to me and he said, George, George, why don't we just simply deal with the obvious? Bum, 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 rhythm. Bum, 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 music. Well, for what more could anyone ask? So forth. So you asked me how they work together. Well, Ira often said, we've often been asked, what comes first, the music or the lyrics? I have one answer for you. The contract.
The mother of invention.
Yes.
Well, he was very good friends with Oscar Levant, as you said. And Oscar played himself in the movie about George Gershwin, Rhapsody in Blue. And Oscar once said that Gershwin was excellent at everything he ever tried, whether it's painting, music, playing tennis, etc. What is one thing that you would like us to know about George Gershwin that most of us may not know?
Oscar Levant said something very funny about George Gershwin because he was naughty. He was also out of his mind. I do know this from the people who did know him. He was sadly, he was quite ill, you know, somehow managed. I don't know how he'd be managed today with what medications, but he was quite ill, and sadly so, because you listen to some of his playing, it's really remarkable, especially the Gershwin stuff. The Chopin stuff is horrid, it's terrifying, but the Gershwin stuff, it's remarkable pianism, so he was the real thing. But he once looked at George and said, "George, if you had to do it all once more, would you fall in love with yourself all over again?" And so you think about things that one doesn't know about George. I have discovered that George was actually not so brash and not so arrogant and not so difficult. If you listen to his radio shows, and they do exist, you can find them on YouTube, in fact, there's a very soft-spoken, sensitive person there. But success in the eyes of the beholder does something very funny to the individual who is successful. Somehow it gives a sheen or an aura that's not necessarily always true to life. And I think George, you know, he was sensitive, he was excited. As Kitty Carlisle told me, she said, you know, you'd go on a date with George Gershwin. I did know her. She was a lot of fun. You go on a date with George Gershwin, and basically he would talk about his music. That would be it. And then she said to me, this is a fun Kitty story. So she was 88 or 89 at this time when I met her. She lived, of course, on the corner of 94th or 96th and Park Avenue, New York, in the 90s there. And she had this wonderful corner apartment, and it was a decorated, it was like a shrine to her husband, you know, to Moss Hart, a total shrine. And he had been dead a long time. And I walked in there, and, you know, she still had legs up to her neck. She was still gorgeous at 90 years old. And we talked a little bit, and I said to her, "Kitty, what drove George?" She said, "Oh, darling, he wanted to be famous." And I said, "And what else?" She said, "That's it, darling." "He wanted to be famous." I said, "No, come on, there's something else." She says, "Darling, I'm telling you, he just wanted to be famous." And then she looked outside of her window as if she was going back 1,000 years in time, and she said, "You know, darling, those two boys, they were really strange." "Now, that piano over there, George played The Man I Love on it. Why don't you?"
George Gershwin did go to Paris, and I believe there he met Maurice Ravel, and there's a story about that, George, about composing. Do you remember that Conversation.
Lunch on me if anybody knows. What is this? Ravel Concerto. Ravel Concerto. So, he goes to Paris and he meets Ravel at a party and he asks Ravel for piano lessons. I once asked Ravel for lessons, you know. Why, he said, would you want to be a second-rate Ravel when you can be a first-rate Gershwin? And besides, exactly how much money does this Monsieur First-Rate Gershwin make now each year anyway? I told him. It was then that he decided he would like to take lessons from me. Now, if you listen that, you hear the jazz, you know? Hmm? And of course, everybody thinks, oh, Gershwin picked this up from Ravel in it. Nope. Ravel composed this after meeting Gershwin, and it was Ravel who stole that jazz move from Gershwin. But you also think the interesting things. Debussy, right? So, you hear those chords, Debussy chords, so beautiful from Reflet dans l'eau. And George always said that he returned home from Paris with suitcases full of Debussy's music, and you really hear those. It's right there. All that wonderful pilfered stuff. I mean, just these moves. Right, and George Gershwin knew how to take those colors and adapt them, but he was totally in love with Debussy and wanted lessons from Ravel, you know, two opposing but the same figures, so very much opposing figures but the same. I find that fascinating. So that's another cross-cultural thing that is so fascinating. And the whole Paris experience for George, I mean, if you think of an American in Paris, for me, that piece is a symphonic poem of the grandest, greatest order. It's like, how'd that dude come up with that 28 years old? It's like, seriously, it's so accomplished on every level and so much fun. And the great thing is it's movie music before there was movie music. Between him and you have to think, Rachmaninoff was at the same time doing other things in the movie music for, and you all this expressive stuff. So to me, there's magic in that, in this oral world that is so mystical, how they did that and figured that out, that then became basically our movie music.
Hmm? Well, do you remember the first Gershwin song or piece you ever heard when you were a little boy?
Yes, and it was as we did before. I've been away from you a long time. Because I was in Miami, as all Jewish boys from Montreal go during the holidays with their grandparents. It's true, right? You know, I mean, I don't know what your ethnic background is, but you know exactly what I'm talking about. All you'd see basically all of us with the luggage going to Dorval Airport on ready for the holiday for the winter holidays to go down to Florida. And I remember my grandparents took me. I must have been, I don't know what, 6 or 7. And we went to the Sectioni Hotel because, you know, in when you're with your grandparents, you speak like this, that's all. And so we went down. It was, you know, my grandfather, he was a big foodie, so you in Austin will understand. You know, at the Sectioni Hotel, you had breakfast, 2 seatings for breakfast, where they serve you omelets that are made for 2 dozen eggs, 1 omelet, right? And it was just a lot of food. So he used to take me down to the 7 o'clock seating, and he would, I was like 6 or 7 years old, and he was a large man, and he would pay off the waiter not to tell my grandmother that we had been there at 7 when we came down again at 9. But this would happen, and then we would go in the evenings with the grandparents to movie night. And I remember seeing the Jolson story. And I remember seeing, but it was, you know, that's where in the Jolson story you see Al Jolson, the real Al Jolson, mouthing, well, he does it, the real Al Jolson sings, and Larry, what was his name? I don't remember the guy, the actor's name. No, Larry Parks? Was it Larry Parks? Or was he the West Side Story guy? No, that was somebody else. It's Larry Parks, I think. Forgive me if I'm wrong. And I saw him singing this Jolson. And I was first introduced to George Gershwin at that point. But for me, even as a 6-7-year-old, the things I was really involved with at the time was Beethoven and Chopin. Those were magical colors to me. Gershwin only came much later. I only heard and really learned the Rhapsody when I was 18. I made my debut in London with it, in South Bank in London, because somebody said, we said, we'd like to invite you to London to play. What would you like to play? Chopin, said, oh no, it's, you know, we have an audience who wants something more upbeat. Okay. And so a friend at music school said, why don't you learn the Gershwin Rhapsody? I said, the Gershwin what? And well, I didn't know. And I learned it, and then the response from the audience was so great, nothing to do with my playing, to the piece. And I realized, ooh, I better learn about this guy. And that's what started that journey. So between that and the Spielberg thing, five, six years later, that all unraveled. led to the most important appearance of my life in Austin.
And you are here. And I will say the performances begin on the 14th of September and run through October the 1st at Zach Theater, Topfer Theater. And I'm going to ask you, Hershey, and then I'll ask George the same question. Sure. What is your favorite George Gershwin tune, and can you play it for us?
The one I'm playing when I'm playing it. But interestingly, you asked me, I actually did play it. I find Embraceable You a very special tune because of its structure. The words for me fit perfectly with the intent of the melody, with the very simple changes in harmony. And it's one of those things that just do exactly and perfectly. You change one thing, doesn't quite work. You can shift within the harmonies, but you know what I mean? You structurally mess that up, it doesn't work. Bernstein always said that you can take the Rhapsody, you can play it backwards, you can play it forwards, up and down, and this way. The melodies work and they're fine. I mean, he was not so nice about it as he could sometimes be. He would say, it's not really a composition. And in a traditional sense, it's this bunch of melodies strung together. Sure, you could call it that if you want to be mean about it, but it's great melodies. Bernstein should have such a success, like the Rhapsody in Blue, right? But at the end of the day, for me, Embraceable You seems to be a perfect example of a perfect song. Harmonically, musically, it's just simple, it's straightforward, worthy of Chopin, I think. You know, that kind of simple, elegant perfection in the key that it was written, it resonates beautifully. So, yeah.
And George, do you have a favorite song of all those you have written?
Do I have a favorite song? Yes. The one that pays me the most in royalties.
Which is?
I think, what is the most that ever paid in royalties? Alexander Rock, Time Bad by Berlin. You know, Berlin threw him out of the office. George Gershwin went to play as accompanist for Berlin, as a song plugger, to try out the new songs. And Berlin said, stop messing around with the things that I wrote, go and get your own life and career, and threw him out. But they remained friends, and the most touching thing is one of the last photographs of George, he was fascinated with gadgets, and he liked doing, you'll never believe this, but it's true, he was so way ahead of the game, he liked taking selfies. And there is a selfie of him and George at George's house, of Berlin and George at George's, one of the last pictures of George a couple weeks before he died, at George's house in Beverly Hills, a selfie of the two of them sitting on the sofa. And it's one of those touching, iconic things. It's just shadowy, and you see these two guys holding the camera here in a selfie. And you think, we are so behind the times today, you know? But, what he would have thought as being the piece that I think is the most successful, I would have to think it would be the Rhapsody in Blue. I would have to think.
Okay.
I think so. But it's in a public domain now, so finished.
Oh, that's done. That's right, yeah. So you can all do modern versions of that.
Ever you want, yeah.
There are some other songs that he wrote. Rhythm, I got Rhythm, you did already, but Fascinating Rhythm, but not
yeah,
for
so
me.
It's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's beautiful stuff.
But not for me.
They're writing songs of love, but not for me. All lucky stars above, but not for me. When every happy plot ends with the marriage, not, but there's no not for me. Such great tunes, one after the other. And then, of course. Are you a singer?
Yes.
Well. Anybody?
The radio.
I know you're a singer, I heard. The radio. The telephone and the movies that we know. Oh, let's begin. It's very clear our love is here to stay. Not for a year. Not for a year, but ever and a day. The radio and the telephone. And the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, be passing fancies, and in time may call. But oh my dear, but oh my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. Together going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble. In time the Rockies may crumble. Gibraltar, Gibraltar may crumble. They're only made of clay. They're only made of clay. But our love is here to stay.
Yeah. Yes. And there's only one reason I chickened out there, because it wasn't in my key.
Except it wasn't
really
his.
yeah, your keys.
So you're mezzo then. You're mezzo.
Mezzo, yeah.
Yeah. We'll get you with the show.
Anyone have a question here in the audience?
Don't be shy. It's only fun when you ask.
Yeah, and it always takes that first brave person, and then suddenly the hands go up.
Well, or they'll just call on them.
And I got to say, you have to be the best audience members, because I forgot to say to turn your cell phones off, and bless you all for having done so. Sir.
What's your reaction to Crazy for You?
As in terms of the play?
Yes.
Well, I saw it in New York a number of years ago, and I liked it. I'm not against this whole concept of rejiggering things to make them work in a contemporary context. You know, I mean, we do it with Shakespeare, we do it with all kinds of things, so why not? I think the important thing is to remember that there is something original. But you know, that kind of vaudeville style, I don't think you could do today and get an audience for it. So it has to be more linear story-wise. And I'm not against being inventive. I'm against pretending that the previous doesn't exist. But, you know, why? You know, if you look at Beethoven writing cadenzas on Mozart's concertos, where's the problem? I mean, it's... But we're clear that Mozart wrote the concerto and that Beethoven wrote the cadenza, so this is not a problem for me. I'm okay with that.
Okay. Anyone else?
Don't be shy. Just call.
Don't be shy.
There's somebody there. I can't see, though.
Yeah.
No, I understand, totally. I do know a little bit about this. Ira was a very bookish character who preferred, because I knew Ira's assistant very well, two of them. Lawrence Stewart was one who I knew very, very well, who was the dearest, dearest, sweetest man in the world. He's gone. And the other fellow who put together the Ira lyrics as a book that was released. And it was very clear that when Ira was approached about, you know, doing story of his life. And he said, write about my brother. I don't really need the attention. I don't know what it was about that his lyrics were so, because he worked very hard of them. I think he really believed in his lyrics and believed they were at the level. I think it was the showmanship that he thought was less. He used to say, let my brother be up front. Let my brother be the star. I'm very happy to sit in the corner with my pen and my paper. I've never read or seen that he felt that his lyrics were less than George's music. I think they really felt to be two parts of one brain.
They were?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Is everybody going to attend Zach Theater's performance? Yeah.
Did their mother like Ira better?
I couldn't hear that.
I didn't hear it. What did
their mother like Ira better?
Did their mother like Ira better?
She was complicated.
So you get to hear
about her in the show, and she was a very complicated woman. This line isn't in the show, but it was told to me by Judy, which is Arthur Gershwin's wife. Arthur was the younger brother, and I met Judy and knew her quite well. I met her in Palm Beach, where else? And she said, you know, Rose, she was a terrible woman, Rose. She was awful. She was a jealous, evil woman. She was terrible. Do you know, once she was asked what she would, by a journalist, what she would do differently if she had a chance to do it all over again? And I said, yeah. So what'd she say? She said, next time, I wouldn't have children.
No favorites here.
And then she says, you know, so what? So this one put lyrics in that one. I could fling my wrist and things would come out of me, you know. So she
wow.
was, but here, the interesting thing about when George died, she made the beeline to the lawyer's office to make sure her name was on, she got the money. It's you know, she was complicated. She was not a particularly nice lady, and there's no... how do you call it? I don't think you'd find anybody who would say Rose Gershwin was a lovely broad. So I don't know where you're going, but
No.
Cool.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Finish your story.
Well, that's the end of that.
Okay. Well, I do have an interesting bit of. It's not trivia because it's certainly not trivial in your life, but you happen to be married to a former Prime Minister of Canada, the only woman Prime Minister of Canada, Kim Campbell. How did you meet?
I was invited when I got to Los Angeles, strangely. Actually, it's good because I've told you a preface to this story, not intending to tell this part, but you so nicely brought it up. No, it's fine. When I was doing that Spielberg thing, there it is, our first phone.
Now you
it
really...
wouldn't have been a party without it. So I was doing the that Spielberg thing that I went to interview, it's true. And I needed my passport. I was going to Europe to interview these survivors as the 50th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz. And I needed my passport renewed. Because I only had 6 months on it or something like that, and you couldn't go overseas. I mean, this is almost 30 years ago. You couldn't go overseas, I think it's still today, with less than 6 months on the passport. So I needed it. So I was in LA, and I went to the consulate, and I told them who I was and what I was doing, and the person who handles culture, said, well, you know, we have the former prime minister coming in. She's going to be the new consul general to deal with very important things, runaway production, film stuff, and so on. They needed somebody very high profile. And of course, I was told that at the time, the new prime minister wanted the competition out of town. So he appointed her to be consul general which is perfectly fair. They were all nice. They're actually all nice people. That's the thing. Maybe not today, but in those days, a lot of those people, a lot of the competitive stuff or the ugly stuff that you see, it's generated because of press. It's generated because of, actually, most of the people I have met in politics really care. You know, and certainly in those days, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, I think things with the internet have changed things a lot. Getting hits, getting attention, saying viral things and terrible things, were a very different time. So in those days, I met a lot of those people. It was very wonderful. And Kim asked me to come and give a concert in her honor because she was arriving to LA and she was going to be the new consul general. So I said, okay, I'll come, I'll play. So they invited their A-list Hollywood stars and whatever else, and it was at the consulate in Hancock Park. And apparently I played well. Because that was 28 years ago, and we've been married for 27 years. And of course it was a big scandal at the time because I'm 21 years her junior. And you know, so they would compare us to Cher and her Baker boyfriend or whatever it was. And then, you know, we've had a very serious, because our approach to ethics is the same. And it's not just, you know, it's not just about men having younger wives, but it's okay for a woman to have a younger husband. Why not? Yeah. And I used to do all the cooking and so on because, you know, I loved being artsy and fartsy. And at one event, Kim said, you know, I was always looking for a terrific wife. I finally have one, you know, and in terms of somebody who would do all the things that traditionally a woman would do in those relationships. And being the artsy-fartsy person in the relationship, I was the one who did that. And Kim was the one doing all the world leadership. It works, but what I have to tell you is this: I'm perfectly happy to share my age. I'm 55. Kim is 76. Because as we say, that you can have privacy, but you don't have secrets. That's all there is to it. And one of the important things that I was confronted with, because I grew up generationally, just after. You know, the point where a woman, it was strange for her to be a doctor. I grew up with women doctors, right? But Kim didn't. You know, you were a secretary, you were a teacher, you didn't do those things. And I always said that my education was so terrific and my generation was the last one because all those women who wanted to be doctors and physicists and rule the world were stuck being teachers. So my generation was essentially the last, not that they're not great teachers now, but this was teaching by necessity, not by choice. And so we had the most wonderful teachers but I did get confronted with something very real, and that is understanding gender issues. And it is such an important thing to understand, and I didn't. Unless you're really confronted with how women are treated, you don't know. And it was a front seat to seeing. You know, I mean, when they would talk about Kim, her predecessor, nobody ever mentioned his tie, and nobody ever mentioned, you know, whether his suit was this color or that color or the next color. But I'll be damned if every single thing didn't talk about, well, why is she wearing the same two earrings 2 days in a row?
I remember.
And
this.
Why, you know, does she not have somebody to look after her shoes? Why is the shoe the same today that it was last week? You remember this stuff.
Je me souviens.
Yeah, you remember all this stuff. And it was so, so unbelievable and real. And I thought, my God, we really do have a lot to work on. But it's in a lot of quarters, but gender issues is something I've been acutely aware of. I'm very proud to be the person doing all those things that were traditionally the wives' things to do at home, sit in a salon and entertain the ladies while the men are smoking and talking the world. So it's been a remarkable life, and I am unbelievably proud of her. And sometimes she said things that are not popular, you know, things that, well, over the years have become popular because we realized that the people she was talking about were not good people. But you don't know what it's like to be in those kind of positions until somebody threatens your life because of something you have said. And I have experienced that as her husband. And what I'm talking about is something to do, you know, forgive me if this is not in the wheelhouse here, but I'm going to pretend. But it was an issue of climate change where she made a very serious statement, and all of a sudden I was getting death threats. I mean, this is not anything that probably today you would think is in question, you know, but, these are serious issues. So you get to understand how people are angry and if they don't understand how they're prepared to threaten your life. So it's scary stuff. But what it has taught me is the unbelievable courage she has had to have over the years to challenge a male-dominated government, to challenge male-dominated ideology, and to not back off of it, no matter what names are called, what life is threatened, is that if you believe in something, and the one thing I can tell you about her, it's the most important thing, what you see is what you get. It's not an act to be elected, because that's long gone. It's, this is what I believe to make the world a better place, and I genuinely believe it. And living with somebody who is that genuine has forced me to analyze my own being genuine about everything all the time. So as I'm talking to you today, this is not a show. This is who I am. Here, you meet me in the restaurant, in the theater. Well, in the theater, I'm George Gershwin, so I'm somebody else. But
he was here
I am, this is me, and I don't pretend to be somebody else because that doesn't get us anywhere.
Here. Beautiful. It's pretty much time for us to say bye-bye for now.
No, I'm having so much fun.
We're having so much fun. Maybe you could
play. May I end with something?
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask.
Okay, I would love to end with something. We've done a ton of Gershwin, but I'd love to do something that influenced me, if it's okay, as a young artist that basically set me on the direction of really understanding what it takes to be an artist, and that whatever it is I do, I will never be this kind of greatness, and to really respect what a person has to go through. So, this is a letter that was discovered in Beethoven's desk after Beethoven died by one of his best friends from growing up who needed to find money to pay for funeral expenses. This letter was completely unknown that he had written to his brother 25 years prior, so 1827, 25 years, 1802, he wrote to his two younger brothers, Karl and Johann, when he was in Heiligenstadt, which is a suburb of Vienna. He was only 31 years old. I will do this letter for you. It's verbatim. And I will then play a little bit for you. And it'll give you I hope that's okay. So this is what Beethoven said. "Oh, you men who declare me to be malevolent, stubborn, and misanthropic, how gravely you wrong me. For you do not know the secret cause behind the appearance. Ever since childhood onward, my heart and my mind have tended towards a gentle benevolence. But for the past 6 years, since my 26th birthday, I have been suffering an affliction that now has no hope of ever being cured. How can I possibly admit to being defective in the one sense which had been more highly developed in me than in other men? A sense which I had at once possessed in its most perfect form. So please, forgive me if I appear to be difficult, but what am I to do? Am I to venture out to a social gathering only to say, 'Speak up! I cannot hear you! I am Dev! And because of this, I have seriously considered taking my own life. But each time I decide on the end, my need for my art returns, and now this is really the only thing that keeps me alive. Death shall now come as he pleases, for no longer shall I invite him. And when he does come, bravely I shall come out, and I shall accept my fate. And when this day happens, I ask of you only one thing. Please. Do not forget me. Because often in my lifetime, I think of you. And I wonder how I can make you happy. Please, just be so. Mm-hmm.